Welcome old family and new family to Cypher Scholars, part education, part hip-hop, all culture. You're listening to your hostesses, Brandon White, a.k.a. Bushido Garvey, as I'm known in many MC circles.
And this is your co-host, Rob Blow.
Yes, yes, yes. Again, just as a gentle reminder, this is Hip-Hop Scholars, part education, part hip-hop, all culture. We try to stay local, global, and universal simultaneously. So what we got on today's syllabus, Rob?
All right, we're going to be talking about the death of John Witherspoon.
Yes, yes.
Second on the list will be VladTV reparation.
Debate and argument and all that.
Yeah, yep. Debate and all that. And last but not least, Donald Trump's impeachment process.
Yes, yes, yes. So let's hop right into it, because we only got 30 minutes, right?
Okay, let's go, man. So we're starting off with John Witherspoon, man.
Yes, yes. Rest in peace to the legend.
Yeah, yeah. You know, it's kind of crazy, man. A lot of these deaths been going on for the past couple of years. Maybe we've been losing a lot of greats, and he's the current one, the late John Witherspoon, man. He did work with
everybody,
Richard Pryor. I think Richard Pryor probably even helped him get started. Maybe, I'm not even sure, but
it was early in the career, the Richard Pryor show, for sure. He was like on all them old school shows, What's Happening, you know what I'm saying? Like Good Time, like he made appearances on all those. Yeah, he made appearances on all those.
I know, and you know, he was known for Friday, you know,
of course,
and,
of course.
Craig's Pops on Friday, you know, tell everyone to get a job, you know,
yeah, right? J-O-B, you hear me? Man, yo, so much childhood, you know what I'm saying? All parts of my childhood, right? Because yeah, Friday as a young person, and then in my later adolescence, the Boondocks, you know what I'm saying? And all the little movies and the
Boondocks,
things he was
going
in
on the Boondocks, man.
Yeah, about, yeah, like granddad.
Yeah.
Trick on my orange juice, boy.
You know what I mean? Yeah, he definitely was very consistent with his comedic skills, you know what
Indeed.
I mean? Always was a hardworking man in the business. You know what I mean? I've never seen him out of show business or anything like that.
He was 77?
I don't even know. Yes, yeah, 77 years old.
And he was still hustling and grinding?
Yeah,
like,
yeah, you know what I mean? Still looking young. I remember he did a show on The Breakfast Club, you know what I mean, for the first time.
That's right, that's right.
And you got a chance to learn a little bit more about him.
Word.
How he operates, you know what I mean?
Indeed.
And it's pretty cool.
I think that's... Well, let me ask you a question, because I said this on Facebook not too long ago. Like, you know how they used to call Bill Cosby America's dad?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
How accurate would it be to say that John Witherspoon was Black America's dad?
I mean, I think that would be very accurate to say. You know what I mean? I think he definitely encompassed that fully. You know what I mean? Like, he was like the common man's America.
Right.
Everyday dad, you know what I mean? Like, you know, go get a job, make sure you stay on top of your grind, you know what I mean?
Go work, go to school.
Family man, you know, married and all of that, you know, he portrayed that in a lot of his, some of the shows they did, you know, especially in Friday for sure.
Right.
What else?
First family show, whatever. So,
you know what I mean? So,
Wayans Brothers,
yeah, definitely. Yeah. You know what I mean? So, like, a lot of his career, he showed that, being a family man, being a father, being a grandfather, you know what I mean, in the cartoon.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I wonder why he doesn't really get that credit. You know what I'm saying?
It's like, kind of crazy, man. If you really look at the career and look at all those shows that he did.
Over decades, you know what I'm saying? And I can't recall one, because, you know, Cosby is often credited for having that positive imagery of like, you know, Black success and Black morals and ethics in television and in movies.
Yeah.
But really, John Witherspoon was that too.
And
obviously, without doing all the date raping and all that craziness, you know what I'm saying?
And probably not. And like, he even showed that I guess he kind of symbolized those that probably didn't make it too well in the college era.
Right.
Like that, you can
still working class.
Yeah,
like,
still working class.
Yeah,
you're in the workforce,
still sharp,
working, man. You know, you're going some type of business or, you know, things of that nature. And
love your family, take care of your family. Yeah,
for real.
Seemed like, I don't know his personal walk in life, so I should probably be careful, but it seemed like out of all these years, we never heard anything disparaging about, like, his real life being that different from how he carried himself in his roles, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, I don't think I ever heard anything too negative and I feel like it might reflect that a lot.
Yeah.
Very closely as well. You know what I mean?
Word up, man. You know, there was a moment when I found out that he passed, which shows that there's some things I gotta deal with in terms of, like, just how I respond to like loss, especially with like celebrities. Does your brain ever hop to conspiracy theory immediately, even if it don't make sense? Like with John Witherspoon, like my brain, I had to shut my brain down and be like, yo, you're wilding right now. Like, you, this is not a conspiracy. You know what I'm saying? Like, because I know, like, in his, some of his last interviews, he was like, kind of like just spilling all the tea on Red Fox and Richard Pryor and everybody. But, like, that's not. It's crazy to think that that's the reason why, you know what I'm saying, he passed. It's just, I think that's just something. I know I can't be the only one either, but like, I know that that was wild and ridiculous, and I had to shut that down.
I'm not gonna lie, that happens to me a lot. You know, it makes you double take on what, like, when you hear of a sudden death of a celebrity that was very prevalent in your life somehow. You know what I mean? Some form of fashion of media. You know what I mean? And you want to know exactly how they die. You know what I mean? But yeah, you can. Yeah, of course you can't go too crazy, and you can't jump out the window too quickly on that, you know.
Right.
You don't want to create too much of a habit of that.
Exactly. No, for sure. Because when the news passed, they didn't, like, when it first passed, they didn't say how he died. So that, I had to work double time to make sure my imagination didn't get the best of me. But then, you know, later on, they talked about it being a cardiac arrest. So
yeah, I never even figured it out, man.
It's a heart thing. Yep. Okay, cardiac arrest. So, you know,
Do you think that's relatively young, 77 years old? Or,
I think when you get up to your 70s, things can happen.
Okay.
You know, your body. You know what I'm saying? Especially if you're, I don't know. There's so many variables. His age, how he was working, but then he might have been taking care of himself. He might not have been, you know, taking care of himself with certain things. Mm-hmm. Who knows? I just know that a lot more things are less in your control by the time you hit 75. Okay. You know what I'm saying? I'm even thinking about my grandfather who passed away not that far away from that age, but he took pretty good care of himself. You know what I'm saying? Okay. For the most part, you know what I'm saying? And you know what I'm saying? He ended up dying around that age. Okay. So that happens. So to run and act like, you know, oh, the Illuminati got the John Witherspoon because he's telling old comedy secrets, like, that's, I had to shut that down ASAP, because that's just unhealthy for me, and it's kind of disrespectful to the family too.
Yeah, definitely, like, man.
You know what I'm saying? So, peace and power to the family, and our prayers and condolences go out to
late great,
John
Witherspoon.
Yes, and his son is funny too. I've never seen his son ever. Yeah, it was on Joe Rogan's podcast when John Witherspoon was on there. He had JD Witherspoon on there, and he was definitely had me rolling. He had a perfect impersonation of his father too. It was pretty funny. So peace to the entire family.
I think I did see that. Maybe, I'm not sure, man. I did see that. That's kind of funny, man.
Yeah. No, he's definitely
just like ODB, right? He got the
The YDB, the his son or whatever. Yeah, so and he seems to have his own style and flavor of comedy too. JD Witherspoon. So
hopefully he'll carry on the legacy of his pop somehow.
And indeed, I'm sure he will. So peace to the Witherspoons. Rest in power to a comedy giant. You know what I'm saying? So
next on the list. So
yes. What's next on the syllabus? Peace to Miss Brady. Peace, everybody listening.
All right, so
CC, what's going on?
So next on
Miss Clark.
My fault. You know, please forgive me, people. Next on the syllabus is the VladTV reparation debacle. This response, debate, whatever you want to call it, man.
Indeed.
How did it start off?
Well, so for those who are on the education side of things, and not on the hip hop side of things, of people listening to the podcast, VladTV is a very popular YouTube channel that a former DJ Vlad interviews a lot of people from hip hop culture, street culture, and politic culture, particularly most focused on African Americans in those particular spheres, in the hip hop culture, the political culture, and the street culture.
Yeah.
So, oh boy, made a tweet saying he's definitely in favor of reparations. Possibly, his exact word is possibly, in the form of college education.
Yeah, college tuition, right? Free college tuition.
Indeed. And, a lot of African Americans, particularly those from the ADOS, that stands for American Descendants of Slavery, who are fighting for reparations, really got at his head about some things. And he's no stranger to dealing with flack, because he often gets
Yeah, he deals with a lot of controversy.
He often gets accused of being a culture vulture and somebody who, you know, takes from the culture more than actually gives to it, or instigates things in the culture more than actually contributes in a positive way.
Yep.
But they was at his head, and the whole discussion came about what say do white people have in a conversation around reparations.
That was definitely a main thing. And the attacks of during the response of his tweet,
right,
where people would say you have no right to even speak on the subject. You know what I mean? So,
right.
You know what I mean,
do you think that white folks shouldn't be speaking on reparations at this point in time?
To a degree, yes, and to a degree, no.
Okay.
I would say why? Because if you go to the government, mostly it's going to be filled with what?
White folks. Okay. Yeah.
So you know what I mean? Yeah. Like. Yeah, no, you know what I mean? Like, in terms of unofficially, no. Officially, yes. You know what I mean? As long as it's within reason, within facts, within the necessary information that creates that boundary.
That part right there, right? Because a lot of folks will be like, we're free to say what we want to say. Everybody's entitled to their opinion. All that is fact. But you're entitled to an opinion, but you have a responsibility to be informed too. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So if you're informed and having these kind of conversations, then that makes a lot of sense in my mind. And it seemed like, at least in some of the interviews that I was hearing him talk about reparations, it seemed like he was trying to be informed, but like it was also a thing where I felt like he was trying to be informed to kind of just justify a limited scope of like what that tweet was saying, because I personally, me, like, I think that he has every right to say what he wants to say. And again, if it's informed, that's dope. It clearly was thinking about it to a certain extent. Like, I guess just with me, like, it's just with me, like, I think white folks have to know that, especially well-meaning ones, have to know that how much they invest in being informed when they make their opinion will shape the thinking of other white people who are trying not to, you know, even entertain the debate.
Okay.
Right. So when he says something like possibly college college tuition, you know what I'm saying? Like, there are gonna be white folks that see that and be like, oh, okay, we can just give them, you know, college. But wait a minute, don't they already have, you know, education of opportunity programs? Like, you know, so that kind of sets things up for not having their thinking pushed about why people are even calling for reparations. You know what I'm saying? So I think that that's what they got to be thinking about sometimes.
Like, I think he's a little off when he speaks. He just speaks in segments, and I don't think he ties his conversation together. I don't think he thinks he speaks holistically, man. Like,
right.
Go ahead.
How much you think is that? My fault to cut you off, but like, how much of that you think is intentional? Him not speaking in total pieces.
I don't even know, man. Like, I really don't know.
Because I can see that, like, trying to drum up.
I think that's just a part of his personality, man. And I don't think he that's a flaw of his. But for example, he would say the difference between Jewish reparations and African American reparation is that Germany was forced to give out the money, right? But when he writes a tweet about reparations being in the form of college tuition, he would say that the reason why of that is because he would feel like the African Americans would squander the money on chains and miscellaneous.
Were those his words? That was his point.
That was the exact words, but basically that was it. And one of those interviews with Talib Kweli,
Trady, and Jamar, you'll hear
one of those, what's name. So I'm like, yo, so you, first of all, you say there's a difference between African American and Jewish, right?
Right.
And you say that Germany was forced to do that, but they had the money, and what did they do? They was able to progress with it, right? Did they squander the money? Did Jews squander the money? No. Right? And that was a different era as well. When we were talking about this was a different era. No, reparation came up in a different era as well.
Right.
And it still is a topic up to today. So just because chains and celebrity, I don't know how to say the word, celebrity dome or whatever.
Right.
Is a big thing that, you know, you're going to equate it to that. You know what
I mean? Right. And I think Because again, I think this is what I feel like white folks need to know when they talk about this kind of stuff. Like, even if you are trying to find the facts, your facts are going to be impacted by your own racial bias. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, that's a fact. You know, Germany had the force.
Yeah.
How relevant is that to the argument? I would argue not that relevant, because at the end of the day, we're trying to get the United States government to do the same thing too. Mm-hmm. And that was never part of the people's reason of being upset with what he had to say.
Yeah.
Right? And it also neglects the fact that Israel, after Germany gave them what the Jewish people plenty deserved, probably even more from Germany. Mm-hmm. I would argue definitely more from Germany. Like, on top of that, though, they got a state. Mm. They got a country that routinely gets hundreds of millions of dollars every year to this day. Mm-hmm. And we can't separate that from reparations. Like, that the reason why they're still getting hundreds of millions of dollars a year is because of what happened then. So, like, those are missing pieces of the argument that I would argue is conveniently missing out.
And there's one more missing piece as well. That's a forgotten piece. And Germany also made their way into North Africa. My friends, have you guys forgotten? Right.
That too.
Have you guys
forgotten? No reparations there.
And that was in the movie with Brad Pitt, if y'all ain't know. Yeah, I mean, but we don't want to get into that. You know,
that's a whole fact, man. That's a whole fact.
Come on. They don't talk about that. And they don't, I got.
You're right. It's kind of crazy. No, you're right, though, man. No, you're absolutely right.
These facts right here. What y'all talking about?
But I honestly, man, I just think it's, even when, again, the bias comes out, because there still can be that attachment to white survival and white domination. Even if they don't really want it immediately as a conscious thought. Mm-hmm. Like, but I'll tell you this, though. Guess what? Guess what's a little bit messed up about it? We're talking more about this white man's thoughts about reparations than we're talking about it, you know, amongst ourselves. At least me and you. Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I feel like that's part of Vlad's. I guess you can call it a strength, or his ability of, like, getting people to talk about what he is doing. Mm-hmm. You know, and I have definitely a love-hate relationship with that channel, as we talk about all the time. You know what I'm saying? But, like, one of the things that is real is that, like, here we are talking about a white man talking about a black issue instead of talking about a black issue.
But he got a black wife, though, you know what I mean?
Oh, does he?
Yeah. Yep, he's dating a colored woman, a woman of color.
Okay.
And he have admitted to this in the past.
Okay. Yep. So before we run out of time, let's talk a little bit about the reparations fight, though. Like, okay, ADOS and them. Like,
okay.
You know what I'm saying? So, this is, one, another preface. Reparations is always something that I thought was important to get, obtain, and fight for. It was also something that I was always worried about it happening in my lifetime.
Okay.
Because I always had a hard time imagining them giving us, well, Yahoo calculated it and said it'd be $17 trillion.
Ooh.
Around $17 trillion if they were to do it, just in the United States alone. So I have a hard time picturing them doing that when they're still oppressing. You do reparations when you're done oppressing, right? But they're still oppressing, so why would they pay? You know what I'm saying? Like, the beginning would be, all right, stop discriminating for housing. Stop discriminating in medical care. Yep. Stop discriminating in education. Yep. Stop discriminating in policing, right? And then you get the bag, right? But not to say that we shouldn't get the bag first. We should get the bag immediately. We should get the money immediately. However, I just know that if an oppressor is still oppressing, they're not even going to be actively thinking about what to give you, unless they give you the money with their own agenda, which brings in the ADOS thing to me.
Okay.
But, yeah, what are your thoughts?
Nah, I agree with you on that. Definitely, yeah, I agree with you on that, man. The government definitely has to stop oppressing everyone, you know what I mean? Like, you guys already apologized for syphilis, right? You guys have admitted to the black the COINTELPRO thing. Like, you know what I mean? Like, you know, we know that U of R, University of Rochester, you know, was doing dirty stuff with the plutonium and this with the citizens.
Rochester himself, and thing, Rochester slave owner. Yep,
slave owner
from the thing,
you're Rochester. You know? But these things do continue to happen to us, right? You still have police brutality, right, amongst the citizens. You still have like the the treatment of white and black people in the system, and the difference within that, you know what I mean? Like, yeah, you know, for the same type of crime, you know, one punishment could outweigh the other.
You right. Know, yeah, still. You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying?
With the ADOS thing, I feel like, just to make it quick, again, it's not going to have a standing because it still focuses on civil liberties.
Got you.
And not national liberties. You know what I mean? But and also ADOS, man, what is this name for again?
American Descendants of Slavery.
Yeah, American Descendants of Slavery. I feel like the history on slavery is not fully understandable as of yet. You know what I mean? Or fully clear. Let me say that. It's not fully clear yet. And I feel like people might have to do a little bit more research on that to even make a stance or claim like ADOS.
Got you. And just in the limited, I'm not even gonna front like I did deep dives on ADOS. Mm-hmm. Like, but when they popped up, I was like, whenever something just randomly pops up, mm-hmm, I always get like a little question mark in my mind, like where'd this come from? Like Antifa. Yeah. Like when they were a thing, I think they're still a thing, but okay, like I was like, where'd that come from? That, yeah. You know what I'm saying? Or even what's another one that kind of popped up? This didn't pop up, but it reminds me of ADOS so far, and all the things I'm learning about it. Because ADOS is seemingly very anti-immigrant, mm-hmm, you know what I'm saying? And has a lot of right-wing leanings, mm-hmm, right? It almost feels like the black version of the Tea Party.
Okay. Yeah.
Where it's these emotional commitments to a left or right ideology are like kind of skewing the message and being more divisive than actually producing fruit. That's what it seems like from this view far, you know what I'm saying? And it's just I know that there have been lawyers and civil rights activists and business owners and historians well before ADOS, mm-hmm, that were working on reparations.
HR 40
is like, how old is that?
Jackson created that.
Yeah, it's like decades old. Yeah, and then it resurfaced now, or whatever, but like there are people working on that hard, but now the whole idea of reparations is attached to ADOS, mm-hmm, right? Like sometimes it's just like, I worry sometimes our movements get engineered by the powers that be. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Like how much of that movement has nothing to do with the actual like original roots of the reparation fixings, you know, of the reparations fight, you know what I'm saying? And how much of it does. So it's just something I have to study up on, but just on surface value, like I was like, okay, I popped up seemingly like in the past 2 years, even though reparations have been popular, been a fight. Mm-hmm. And then there's all this division that happens when y'all do this, like, and how y'all approach it. Like that's agent work. Whether or not you are a paid FBI or CIA agent, it's still like doing the work of agencies. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, which, you know, I think all of us have embedded in our psychology if we don't unpack them, because we all raised in the system. You know what I'm saying? So, and that might be a very bold statement that I just made, but so anybody that knows more about ADOS or is a part of ADOS,
come see me because I'm eating.
Please reach out to us at Cypher Scholars, and we'd love to hear the standpoint. We'd love to hear the standpoint and get more knowledge and wisdom and understanding, right?
As our
5% brothers say. So,
we're good on time.
Yes, we are. So, impeachment. Man, talking about our systems and the political theater.
From reparations to impeachment, we still in the Congress. We still talking
peace
about
to Larkin
right
for
now.
Listening. Peace to Chris for listening. Peace to my brother Manny for listening too. Appreciate you.
All right, so we got this new thing. Well, it's been going on for some months now, I believe, at least a year, where Trump they actually did a House resolution, or they held a vote in the House of Representatives to start a resolution on the impeachment of Donald Trump.
Right. Because the whole Ukraine quid pro quo. Part of my fluency challenge right there.
There's many reasons. Like one reason could be that he's making money outside of the presidency, I believe.
Right.
Through having executive workers work and live at his apartments in New York City, or you know what I mean, those apartments in his buildings, basically his residencies, instead of doing the proper protocols, I guess, and doing it the regular way, I guess. You know, things like that. Also, because of Syria, I think a couple other things too. I'm not fully violating the constitutional amendment clause. You know what I mean? By yeah, you know what I mean. Things like of that nature. You know what I mean?
So, yeah. Do you think that this is a worthy? Do you think that it makes sense for the Democrats to be going after this impeachment?
Yeah and no, I think. Yeah and no. Yes, okay. Yes, because of the racial stance that he takes, you know what I mean, the way he conducts himself in the public eye, he's very rash, you know what I mean? He's very brash as well, you know what I mean? He's kind of reckless on Twitter and stuff like that. And you know, he has bad situations with females, you know what I mean? Also with the African American community, things like that. But no, when it comes to like his maybe his business proceedings and the way he handles his business, he's still reckless in the business field though. But
I'm gonna be battler's advocate. Mm-hmm. For those that don't know, I say battler's advocate instead of devil's advocate. Mm-hmm. So you talked about possibly making money on the side, right? In the whole Ukraine situation. Yep. Do you think this is the first time that a president has tried to do something like this?
No, I do not.
You think this is the first time that there is a record of a president trying to do these kind of things?
Nah, not at all. I mean, I feel like there might be some records of these presidents doing outside business with other organizations, I believe.
So why should Trump be impeached? I got my MAGA hat on right now.
You know, they're saying that, of course he is violating his, he's not doing his job, I guess. You know, he's not following the rules to his job. And basically that's in a nutshell, you know what I mean? Like, for example, what else?
He said not following the rules to his job.
Yeah, but basically, you know what I mean? He's went against the Pentagon, right? National Security Act. He did something with the National Security Act, and that went against the rules of what Congress wanted, et cetera. You know what I mean? So he's basically stepping out of bounds with his job. He's beefing. He's contributing to infighting, and he's beefing with some of the wrong organizations in the government. You know what I mean?
So how much of this has to do with his corruption, and how much of it has to do with him not doing the corruption the way that they want him to do it?
First of all, I feel like they all have wrongdoings. They all have been corrupted in some form of fashion, and to some degree. I just feel like Trump is a little bit more in the open with it. You know what I mean? Like he says that he's wanting to drain the swamp, and it looks like he's focused. And when he's firing people, it looks like he's focusing on a certain number, a certain group of people. It seems, you know what I mean? Mm. I don't know what group that is. I don't know what organization that could be a part of. You know what I mean? But obviously, he's definitely beefing with the Democrats. You know what I mean? The Republicans are on his side. But you also got to ask this question too. Like, let's think about Bill Clinton. Did he go through an impeachment process?
He did.
Did he get impeached?
He did.
No, he did right? not.
I could have swore he got impeached.
He did not get impeached.
Hold on.
Boy, Bill Clinton did not get impeached.
Hold on.
He went through an impeachment process,
right,
but
went through the process, and I thought he got impeached.
He did not get impeached. These are facts.
Bill Clinton.
He was not impeached. These are facts right here. I know. Man, I don't need the computer.
It said, although proceedings were delayed due to the bombing of Iraq on the passage of House Resolution 611, Clinton was impeached on December 19th, 1998 by the House of Representatives. So the whole thing of getting impeached,
he
got impeached.
No, he got, you know why? Because, okay, you got to look at the process of impeachment.
Right.
It has to start off in the House of Representatives, right? If it passes through the House of Representatives, they'll set up a committee and do investigations.
Right.
Right. If you look at
that's the step they're in right now with Trump.
But it has to end up in the House of Senate.
Right.
In the Senate, I'm sorry. And if it's a majority vote, 2/3 majority vote, then you can get convicted.
Right.
Right.
Yes.
So what's his name never got convicted. He got impeached, but he didn't get convicted.
That's not what you said. It doesn't matter.
When you think about impeachment, you think about leaving office, right?
No, I don't. Because impeachment. Here's my understanding of impeachment.
That's what general people are thinking about.
But what the law says, it basically impeachment creates the ground for that to happen. Mm-hmm. For you to get kicked up out of office, right? It's like an official statement. Like, all right, you could possibly get your way up out of here. Mm-hmm. It's like having your shield taken down. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Like, and then they might mollywop you up out of there. Right. But that's the process of impeachment. I learned that through the Bill Clinton process.
Let's make it simple. Impeachment means accusations. You get impeached, you got accusations against you. Right? Yes. It's official. Formally official accusations levied against you, right? So what happened with Bill Clinton? He had the Lewinsky scandal, right?
Right, and he lied under oath.
He lied under oath and all that, right? But he still kept his job, right? Yeah. So you can create affairs in office and still keep your job, right?
Yep, absolutely.
Never left his office. He finished his, right? So I'm going to call it the Clinton impeachment plan. If you follow the Clinton impeachment plan, Trump is actually, this is what's going on. If you look up LA Times, there's an article on LA Times that talks about if Trump follows Clinton's impeachment plan, he's going to keep his job.
Yeah.
Right. So it's little things like him not avoiding the GOP allies, right. Him keeping away from impeachment. Him basically stating that impeachment is an unfair process. If he do these things and stay on top of his agenda and does what he's supposed to do, I'm telling you, he's gonna keep his job. He won't get impeached. I promise you this.
Right. Or he may get impeached, right, but may not deal with the conviction.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He might not get convicted. That's the thing. Yeah. He might not get convicted in the Senate.
Right. Right. Right.
That's the final stage of the impeachment process.
Yep. So. In the light of that heated discussion about impeachment, we got to close out the session today. Y'all been listening to Cypher Scholars, part education, part hip-hop, all culture. Catch us every Tuesday from 1:30 to 2. Peace the Monster for listening, by the way. You know what I'm saying?
And don't forget to donate. You can also donate at donate.whalefm.org.
Yes. We got to keep this station rolling and going.
Content, you know?
Indeed. Peace and progress, y'all.